Yeah.
So.
All right.
No. It's all the best we can do.
No problem.
Good morning.
Morning.
Welcome to the well. It's good to see all of you here on this beautiful Sunday morning. We pray that God will touch your life, your heart, your soul, your mind, and that you will meet him face to face today during this service. Let's go to God with prayer and open our hearts to him. Gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we come into your house today to meet you face to face. Help us to meet you face to face this morning. May your Spirit speak to our hearts. May whatever problems we are going through right now, may you give us hope, that hope that can help us go through any difficulty. And as we worship and praise you today, we ask that your presence would just come mightily, wonderfully, touch our hearts, come into this place like we haven't ever experienced it before. Come and speak to us and let us know that you are God, and that we are yours, and that we are thine. In the name of your Son, Jesus, our Redeemer, who lives, we pray.
Amen.
The stand for you are able as we worship and praise our living Redeemer. Youth, come up here.
So I brought this book with me today. I used to read it to my girls all the time. They loved it. It's called Alexander and the Terrible, Horrible Language. Very good. Have y'all ever read this book?
Yes.
Okay, so we're just going to read a few pages of it this morning. So Alexander says, I went to sleep with gum in my hair, and now there's gum. I went to sleep with gum in my mouth, and now there's gum in my hair. And when I got out of bed this morning, I tripped on the skateboard, and by mistake, I dropped my sweater in the sink while the water was running, and I could tell it was going to be a terrible, horrible, no good, very bad day. We're not going to read the whole book. We're just going to read a few select pages. In the carpool, Mrs. Gibson let Becky have a seat by the window. Audrey and Elliot got seats by the window, too. I said I was being scrunched. I said I was being smushed. I said, if I don't get a seat by the window, I'm going to be parsed. No one even answered. I could tell it was going to be a horrible, no good, very bad day. There were two cupcakes at Philip Parker's lunch bag. Alfred got a Hershey bowl with almonds, and Paul's mother gave him a piece of jelly roll with a little coconut sprinkles on the top. Guess whose mother forgot to put in the dessert? I can tell it's going to be a horrible, terrible, very good, bad day. Then he got ready for bed. My bath was too hot. I got soap in my eyes. My marble went down the drain, and I had to wear my railroad pajamas. I hate my railroad. So he was having a pretty bad day, right? I know that y'all have bad days sometimes. So, but Alexander forgot to do something. What did he forget to do? Pray. He didn't go to God with any of his problems. So what Alexander needs to know, what y'all need to remember, is that God is big. He's bigger than any problem that we will ever have. That God loves us. He loves us so much that he's willing to take on our problems and help everybody with their problems. If we pray, God can give us a peaceful feeling inside. He can comfort us. And if we're feeling down, if we hold on to our faith, he can lift us up and make our problems better. And sometimes he can help us even see the good in some of the problems we have. I know that's hard to believe, but it's true. Sometimes we don't understand why things are happening, but later on, we'll understand that that problem is actually a gift from God. Things are better. So anyway, if y'all are having a bad day like Alexander, just remember to keep God in your heart and pray and we'll give you comfort. Okay, let's pray. Dear God, thank you for these kids here. Thank you for all the little kids and the big kids everywhere. We know that sometimes we have problems, God, and thank you for just being there. Thank you for being a big God who loves us and lifts us up and helps us to understand our struggles and give us peace. In your name we pray, amen.
Amen.
All right, if you would, open up your Bibles to Job chapter 19, verses 23 through 27. This is Job speaking to his friends. Job 19, 23 through 27. Oh, that my words could be recorded. Oh, that they could be inscribed on a monument, carved with an iron chisel and filled with lead, engraved forever in the rock. But as for me, I know that my Redeemer lives, and he will stand upon the earth at last. And after my body has decayed, yet in my body I will see God. I will see him for myself. Yes, I will see him with my own eyes. I am overwhelmed at that thought. May God bless the hearing and reading of God's holy word. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts, all of our souls, and all of our minds, may they be truly and utterly faithful to your word, O Lord our God, our rock and our redeemer. We ask this morning that you would speak to us, that you would show us your face, that we would know you, that we would see you, and that you would lift us from the ashes of life. That you would bring us resurrection power. And that power would help us to overcome anything this world could throw at us. In the name of our Redeemer, Jesus, we pray. Amen. There's probably no other character in the Bible that people can relate to more than Job. How many of y'all can feel like you're just like Moses? I mean, anybody out there? I mean, I know I can relate to Moses' weak points, but I could never say that I could stand up and make the Red Sea part or anything like that. Or, you know, Elijah, you know, one of the great prophets of all time. People don't really associate with Elijah a whole lot and say, well, you know, I'm just like Elijah or Elisha or any of those prophets. But over and over throughout my ministry, I've heard over and over again people say, I feel just like Job. Every one of us at some point has probably felt like Job. And if you don't know the story of Job, Job had everything. Job had the perfect life. He had the perfect job. He had the perfect family. He was richer than anybody else in all the world. And then one by one by one, tragedy struck Job over and over and over and over and over again. I mean, first off, he lost his wealth. His wealth was wiped totally away. Then his family was wiped away. He lost all of his children. There's nothing worse than losing a child. Then his health started deteriorating, and he just got worse and worse and worse until the point where he declares that he wishes that he had never been born. Just like George Bailey. I wish I'd never been born. It would have been better if I'd never been born. That was chapter 3. All of that happened all through that. Job's friends come to comfort him, and they don't do a whole lot of comforting. They accuse him over and over and over again of sinning, of having some sin in their life, because people believed at that point that if your life was good, then you were following with God. But if your life was bad, then you had some sin in your life that you were being punished for. And the whole reason that Job was written was to show that, you know what? Bad things happen to good people. Tragedy happens in the world. And how do you go about living through that? And you've probably heard in your life someone say, oh, they have the patience of Job. Well, if you've read along with us in this book, was Job very patient? I mean, from chapter 3 until chapter 41, what is Job doing? He's complaining. He's griping. He's yelling at God. He's yelling at his friends. He's yelling at his wife. He's saying, this is horrible. This is terrible. Just like that. No good, very bad day. Job's not a saint by any means, and everybody lifts him up and says, oh, Job, you know, he's got the patience of Job. Job wanted to lay down and die in chapter 3. He'd given up all hope. And he complained about God. He blames God. He yells at God. He yells at his friends. I mean, just here in chapter 19, he tells his friends, well, y'all are no good. He tells about all the problems he has in his life. He says he blames God for every single one of the problems that he has in his life. He says, God caused this, God caused that, God made this happen. All these problems, all these troubles, all these hurts, all these heartaches, this is all God. God did this to me, and I don't know why. I am innocent. I am innocent as the day is long. I have not done anything at all. I am innocent of all of this. And there goes Job's friends again saying, no, you're not. You are guilty. And Job looks at him and he says, you know what? He's holding in one hand going, you know what? I have a Life is the worst that it ever could possibly happen. Life is horrible, horrible, terrible, just disgusting. And on the other hand, he declares right here in verse 23, he wishes this, his words could be recorded for all time, carved on a stone of a monument. But as for me, I know that my Redeemer lives, and he will stand upon the earth at last. You know, Job yelled and screamed at God. Job declared, you know, God, why aren't you here? Why aren't you helping me in all this circumstance? And he's yelling in one hand, and then the other he's declaring, but you know what? I know that God is going to save me. There is a Redeemer out there. There is someone who's going to redeem all of these problems. There's somebody out there that's going to help us. That word Redeemer in Hebrew is like the word used for God delivered the Egyptians out of slavery. It's like if you owed a debt that you couldn't pay, somebody who could redeem that debt for you, even when you can't pay it. It means that there's somebody out there that's going to save you when you can't be saved. And at this time that the book of Job was written, people didn't believe there was an afterlife. They didn't believe that when you die, you go to be with God. They believed that you lived on through your children. And so here is Job, who his whole world has been ended, meaning that he's not going to live on. He declares, you know what? I know with all my heart, I know with all my soul that I'm going to be. One day, I am going to be declared free. I'm going to be saved by someone. He had that Easter kind of faith before there was an Easter. He knew that he was going to be free. You know, as much as Job complains about everything, he made it through those circumstances because he held on to his faith. He held on to his God even when he felt like God had abandoned him. Even when he had given up all hope, the one hope that he had is even that God would not forsake him. When we go on the few chapters, his friends complain a little bit more about him. They call him a sinner, all these different little things. And then finally, God comes down and speaks to Job. He comes down and Job meets God face to face. He is there and God meets Job where Job is. He says, Job, I've heard all your complaints. I've heard everything you said. But you're not going to understand. How many of y'all have sat there at the worst part of your life and cried out, why, God? Why? I know I have. I know I've been there crying out, God, I will never understand why this was allowed to happen. And as people of faith, we're going to cry out to God, and God, I don't understand. I don't know why this happened, why this tragedy went on. We can hold on to the knowledge to know that God will always be there to the end. Well, after God speaks to Job in chapter 42, some of you might not have read chapter 42, it's today's reading with that. Through all of this, Job says this in chapter 42. Up until this point, I had only heard about you before. But now I have seen you with my own eyes. See, Job was living out of faith where he just knew about God. He did not yet know who God was. He hadn't met God personally. He hadn't met and known a God that loves and cares, but he was trying to live that out. And through the tragedies that he went through, he met God face to face. Early on in my ministry, there was a a church member. He was one of those active church members. He did everything. He was on every board. Anytime the church was open, he was there. If somebody needed something, he was there. If somebody was struggling, he was there for them. If they went on a mission trip, he was on that mission trip. He did everything. He taught Sunday school. He was one of those people that pastors just love having in church because they you don't even have to ask, they do it. He had a 13-year-old son, was married for all these years, and had one of those couples where people would look at him and say, man, this is great. They've got it all. He was active in the community, was in service clubs, was in politics. It was everything. And one day, he wasn't feeling real good. He went to his annual checkup. And they found a tumor, cancerous tumor this big inside. And they said, there's nothing we can do. You're not going to live for 6 months. And the church rallied around. The church was there and they said, we're going to have a healing service. And we're going to pray for you. And so one Sunday, the whole congregation had a healing service, and he came up to the front of the church, and half the congregation came down, laid hands on him. The pastors put oil on his head, prayed for him. I mean, they had a huge service. And other people came down, and they prayed for healing, and they asked God to intervene in their lives. And the man went back to the doctor, and the tumor had shrunk. And so everybody was just they were excited about it. So he went and he started taking chemo and the radiation, and you all know how that ravages the body and how it hurts and how it just takes over. And he struggled through all that, and so we can have another healing service. And he comes down, and people from the community came in to pray for him because that's how much that people laid hands on him. And he went back to the doctor, and guess what? Cancer was still there, still that same size. He started getting weaker and weaker. 6 months had passed, and he made it past that, and then went to 9 months, and everybody just knew, hey, something's gonna happen. He's gonna live. He's gonna make it through. A year later, he's still going through all of those treatments. The congregation still rallied around him. We want to have another healing service. So he came down again, and the pastors laid hands and put oil on him. There were 40 people all around the altar, from one side of the altar to the other side. All these people there praying for his healing. He went back to the doctor. That cancer was still there, that same small size. He started getting weaker, 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 and that cancer started taking over, and he just didn't think he could come and go on anymore. And we talked to him. We said, hey, how are you doing through all this? He said, you know what? I finally understand the book of Job. I said, what do you mean? He said, I finally understand the book of Job. And I'm like, okay, I mean, do you feel like Job? I said, I feel like Job at the end of the book. You see, because my whole life I had known about God. I knew that God was good. I knew that God was love. I knew that God had done all these miraculous things. I knew that God was the God of the Old Testament and the New Testament. I knew that Jesus Christ died. I knew that Jesus Christ died for my sins, but I did not know, and I had not seen Jesus face. Okay. He said, but through this disease, I have now seen God. I have now seen him with my own eyes. I just don't know about God. I know the God that created the heavens and the earth. I know the God that was there when the tree sprung up. I know the God that was there when the fish went into the sea. I know the God that was there who died for me on the cross. I know Him personally, and I have seen Him face to face through all of this. I said, well, if you could go back and not have this cancer, what would you do? I said, I wouldn't change it. Romans chapter 8 says, does it mean that God doesn't love you if bad things happen? No. It says nothing in all the world can separate you from the love of God through Christ Jesus. Does hardship? No. Do angels? No. Do devils? No. Does sickness? No. Does death? No. Nothing in all creation can separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Not having heart attacks in the service when a cane falls. Nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. And you may be feeling a little like Job today. The whole world might be crashing in on you. You may be thinking, God, why in the world is this happening? But you know what? As God's children, we'll never know. Sometimes bad things happen. Good happens to bad people. Bad happens to good people. Bad happens to bad people. But I do know without a doubt that God loves us, will never fail us, and never leave us. And I know without a doubt that God can bring good out of any situation if we keep that faith through it all. Now that doesn't mean you are allowed to sit there and yell and scream and cuss at God just like Job did. Did Job get in trouble for any of those things? No. The one thing that kept Job through it all was that connection. He never lost connection. He prayed and he prayed and he cried out to God and he never gave up and he said, God, 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 help me, God, through this all. God, I don't understand. He kept that conversation open. And at the end, when God talks to Job's friends, do you know what they got in trouble for? The Bible says that they didn't talk about God right. Well, in Hebrew, it really means they didn't talk to God right. They didn't pray for Job through all those hardships. What they did was they judged and they told him that it was his fault. They told him that God wouldn't do this if he wouldn't have done something wrong. Job kept those lines of communication open and prayed and searched and called out to God night and day. There was this little old lady in one of the churches I served, and after one of my sermons, she came up and she said, you know, I don't know how people make it through this life if they don't know God. And I looked at her and I said, I don't either. I don't. You feel like Job today. Do you feel like the world is crashing in? Know that we can know and see a God who loves us unconditionally, loves us so much that He came into the world to die for our sins. He came into this world to redeem this world, to save this world, to give us new life, to help us to get through those difficult circumstances, and that He'll never, ever, ever forsake us or leave us. May you find and see God today. Let us pray. Loving Lord, we pray your Spirit would come into this place right now. Help us to see. Help us to know your love. Help us to know there's nothing that can separate us from that love. Not hardship, nor pain, nor grief, nor anything in all creation that can separate us from your love. And Lord, if there's people here today who never met you face to face, who haven't experienced that love, who haven't seen you personally, who maybe just know about you, may you open their hearts so that they can see you right now, so they can feel your presence. Come into their lives in a powerful way, take over, and Lord, help them through all those difficult circumstances. And we praise you so much that in the midst of the storm, you are always there. Even when we don't feel like we can see you, you're there. And we thank you that you never give up on us, even sometimes when we give up on you. It's in the name of the risen Jesus, our Redeemer, that we pray.
Everybody, before we get into joys and concerns, let us greet each other for a couple of minutes. Understanding, reason, logic, anything. All we can say with conviction is that we love you and we're here for you. I want to let everybody know there's flowers up here on the altar of the Barb and Tom too, in memory of this little park or so. All right. Anybody over here have joys or concerns on this side? Anybody on this side? Yes, sir.
Continue prayer to God and to the family of their journey.
Okay.
All our law enforcement, first responders, active duty military personnel that are guarding us and watching over us and protecting our rights. They should be the last day of the legislative session back here, just hoping that they finally come to a decision on what they're going to do with the budget.
Good.
And prayers are continued good health to you.
Bless you, man. Yeah. Get more live.
Healing up on you, Jeff.
Yes, it's tough when you start realizing your mortality a little bit, you know, so, which I have here lately. I seem to be a little shakier than I used to be 10, 15 years ago, so I'm working on it. So bless y'all for all your prayers and concern. Just remember me and thinking about this. It makes a huge difference. It really does. Good mouse over here. Yes, ma'am.
We've got several of our youth this next week. It'll be at CCE. So let's, keep them covered for this week. And Mark, too, because Mark's one of the spiritual directors.
All right. Okay.
I just have a joy.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, my younger sister, she just started with the facilities. And she's retired, attorney that she was loved. She had to retire. But you know what she says all the time? She says, I remember a client. And he would always come in and I'd say, oh, Mr. Bill, how are you doing today? And he said, attorney Sandy, it's just so good to be signing. And she said, Attorney Sammy, it's so good to be signing in. And she said, I finally realized what it meant. It was just so good to wake up early. So that's a joy. And then keep my sister safe in your prayers.
Okay.
And I thank God for all these people, Marie and everybody that took care of my mother, and how God surrounds me even now back here with these very people that are praying for us.
Thank you. Anybody else? All right. Keep my daughter Jennifer. All right. In 3 weeks, she's going to be going through a tough thing with brother James. All right. All right, then. Well, let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we come here today, listen to the story of Job. We just ask that you would grant us some sliver of light in the darkest times. Times when we don't understand, where our wits end, or we're angry, or just numb. God, can grant us just some sliver of light. You just help us to remember that if we do wake up and draw a breath, it is a joy. It is another day to be with family and friends. God, this week, just lift up the Lucy Platton family during this time of loss and grief. Let's pray that you would just be there for them. Let them feel your presence. Just give them strength right now. Just provide them the peace only you can provide. God, we lift up the Rosinskis to give them safe travels. Lift up our youth and Pastor Mark as they go to this conference to give them safe travels. Bless them while they're there. God, we lift up Krista's daughter Jennifer, who is going to be facing a tough time in a few weeks, that you be with her and let her feel your presence as well. God, we lift up Silver's sister Sammy, lift her up to you also. And God, we just want to pray for all of our military, all of our first responders, policemen, firefighters, everybody who's in harm's way, that you protect them, keep them safe. They would also feel your presence too. God, we do pray that you would direct our government, our legislators, that you would give them clarity and reason. God, you just guide their ways. They would remember that who they serve. God, we should pray up everybody else too, that the sick and needs your healings, lift up any unspoken prayer requests. Thank you for the recovery I've made, Lord, and just pray for continued healing for my body as well. God, we just ask now that you would let us come to you and pray the way that Jesus taught us to pray. I say, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses. We forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory forever. Amen. Now if y'all would join me in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven. He sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. Thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Oh yeah.
Thank you.
joint on Fern, not Frank's Louisiana Kitchen, but Frank's the pizza joint. What do they call that place? Anyway, tomorrow night from 5 to 9, you go over there and 8-10% of all the sales are going to go towards Think First. What does Think First do again?
Traumatic brain injury, spinal cord support group, well, prevention group, kind of get individuals to think before they act, not have any drink and drive or drive it up or seat belt and stuff like that.
Right.
It's a prevention group.
Okay.
It's international.
Right, you know, Dwayne gave me this, it made me think of Mac Marsh. Mac Marsh always had a story, he worked at Think First, and Mac Marsh was, I mean, I knew Mac Marsh when he owned a gift shop over in front of Horseshoe called Crazy Crawfish. And I went and called him way a long time ago when I was working in sales. I saw Mac Marsh, I talked to Mac Marsh. The next time I saw Mac Marsh, he was in a wheelchair. Mac Marsh already kind of pulled too hard. Go off in the shallow of the pool. That was all it took. So he's a big proponent of Think First. And it's an education about just being here. that's tomorrow night at Frank's from 5 until 9. Also, the red bags are in the back, so if you pick one up, don't miss your opportunity this week to fill it with this all-time showstopper, Vienna sausage. Ramen noodles. Fruit, canned fruit, cereal, rice, if possible, but Vienna sausage. What can you say about that other than spam? I don't know what the top of that. So, what's that? Maybe throw in a little devil of ham. They used to have devil of ham in cans.
What is that?
Yeah. Throw in a little bit of that. Got yourself a meal. All right. So be sure to pick up a red bag. Stewardship team meets July 2nd at 2 o'clock in the conference room. Sam Booth Help, I think that's in the traditional service, but if anyone wants to help out.
I think we need that. Both.
You can't leave from here and go there. Need you over here. Vacation Bible School is coming up soon, July 8th to 11th. If you'd like to help out, contact Michelle. The phone number's in the bulletin here. There's also a list of items that are needed to be donated to, so sign up for that, or we'll take a monetary donation. If you'd like to help out the flower beds, contact Donna Kemp in the prayer garden area. There's someone down in the sanctuary too. So midweek prayer services this Wednesday at 12 o'clock in the sanctuary. And let them know, be sure to fill out the attendance pads. If you'd like to volunteer to be part of the team to go out and meet the neighbors in our community, contact Pastor Mark. Any other announcements, Bill? I miss anything? All right, let's stand for our last song. If y'all want to come over here and pray, if you want to talk, I'll be standing over here. You're welcome to do so. And let us stand. Thank you.
glad y'all came today. Let's be dismissed. Father God, please help us to remember we do need you. God, life deals us things that we just don't understand. We just question it. There's no reasoning for it, God. Pray that you help us remember two things. One is that you're not going to forsake us. The second thing is, God, is nothing to separate us from you, from your love. That's the end. We just have faith. God, be with us this week, I pray. Give us opportunities, I pray, to be of service to others. I lift this up in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Baby.